coming. So today I'm going to be talking about the uncertainty evaluation of our new primary frequency standard at NRC, the FCSM2 fountain clock, and this is an evaluation that we're just near completion. So FCSM2uses refurbished subsystems from our previous fountain, NRC-FCSM1, so that's the optical system, the electronic system, microwave system. They've all been basically redesigned and upgraded at this point. But the physics package for FCSM2 was actually designed and built at NPL. So this was a commercial and scientific collaboration where NPL were contracted to build a physics package for us based on the design of F2 and F3, their F2 and F3 fountain clocks. And during the construction and testing, NRC staff such as myself and another colleague went over to help with the assembly and the testing before it was shipped to NRC under vacuum across the Atlantic, and it arrived under vacuum as well, which was good. And that arrived in early 2017. And since then, we integrated it with our other systems. Within a few months, we were able to get Ramsey fringes and start to evaluate the performance of the entire system as a whole. So I won't go into too much detail about the physics package itself. So this is a reference that has a lot more detail if you're interested. But a couple of the more important features for us, it's a mod-loaded fountain, so we use a mod as a cold atom source. We do use an optical pumping stage, so there's a dedicated port for that, just above the mod, and that gives us about a factor of 4 increase in our signal size. Our cavities are designed at the Gibble group at Penn State, non-cylindrical cavities meant to minimize DCP shifts. And additionally, there's a double-walled aluminum cell around the flight region here, which serves as a water cooling jacket. So we flow water through temperature regulated from a chiller, and that helps minimize the uncertainty due to black body radiation. So that's what it looks like before the new metal shield layers go on. Okay, so our optical system is relatively straightforward. The key pieces really are the two lasers. So we have an external cavity diode laser for a cooling laser. That only outputs a bit more than 10 milliwatts, so we amplify that twice with tapered amplifiers. But the repumper, we have lots of power. That's a DVR, top-decker DVR laser. It's capable of outputting hundreds of milliwatts, but we only need about 35, so we run it at quite low current. They're locked using modulation transfer spectroscopy setups, and these are quite robust. They'll maintain lock for months at a time. Typically, whenever they go, it's because we're doing something on the table and messing around. And all the light is brought over to the physics package via optical fiber, which are mounted onto cage systems and then directly attached to the vacuum system. And so that helps quite a bit with the alignment stability. Okay, so this is a picture of our microwave, a schematic of our microwave system. Here the key components are our synthesizer, which is a spectrodynamics CS1 unit. And that is referenced to our Remia maser, which provides it a 5 megahertz reference input. The output of the SDI then gets sent to interrogate our atoms. We do the typical interrogation where we probe on each side of the central Ramsey fringe, calculate a difference in transition probability, convert that to a correction frequency, feed that back to the SDI through the DDS to close the servo loop. And the Remia maser also serves as our flywheel for any comparisons through GNSS. Okay, so as you've heard in some previous talks, the cold collisions can be a major contributor to uncertainty in fountain clocks. You have to balance the need for a large number of atoms for sufficient signal to noise with the fact that they interact and can collide and cause a frequency bias. So in our typical protocol, what we do is we utilize a method developed at NPL where they found that if you tweak certain parameters such as your initial cloud size and the pulse area of your first Ramsey interaction, you can work in a regime where the energetics of the collisions actually lead to a minimal collisional shift. So we do that, and we're typically able to keep the collisional shift for our low density set up to about a part in 10 to the 15 or lower. But it's not perfectly stable, so we still dynamically correct for it. So we'll measure at high, or sorry, at low density for about 85% of the time. Then we'll increase the atom number by about a factor of 7 or 8, run for basically the remainder of the time with a very small amount of time. This black strip is overrepresenting it, but about maybe 1% or less. We'll go to a magnetically sensitive transition, lock to that just to keep track of what the C field is doing. So doing this collisional shift correction, it reduces the collisional shift as a type B uncertainty, but that comes at the cost of reducing degrading your signal to noise, your short-term stability. And so at high density, we get something like just over a part in 10 to the minus 13, 1 over square root of averaging time for short-term stability. But when we do this collisional shift correction, that gets degraded to about 1.5. But for room temperature local oscillator, that's still quite good, so we're quite satisfied with that. Okay, so this is our error budget at the moment. This is what it looks like. As you can see, there are many contributions. I won't have time to go through all of them, but I will go through a couple of the more relevant ones, maybe. So by far the largest, as it is in many fountain clocks, is the second order Zeeman effect. But that one is relatively straightforward to characterize, because basically you need to know that your field is relatively homogeneous during the Ramsey interaction time, and you need to know its temporal stability as well, or you need to be measuring it quite consistently. So what we do, well, you can map the field by simply launching the atoms to various heights while measuring a magnetically sensitive transition, such as the MF equal minus 1 to MF equals minus 1 transition. And you can map out the field, and when we do that, we see that it's uniform to better than a percent. This is the typical launch height in our situation for our typical protocol. And in terms of temporal stability, as I said, we've worked this into our normal operation. We measure it regularly. And so this shows about a month's worth of data, and you can see that it doesn't move very much. And so the gray band here shows the width of a Ramsey period, essentially. So if it jumped over and we're measuring the wrong Ramsey fringe, it would be up here somewhere. So it's quite stable, and this is a very quick measurement to make sure that our field isn't moving too much. And so putting these things together, although it's a large bias, the uncertainty is actually quite low. The next biggest is the black body radiation, which again for room temperature fountain clocks is typical. And for this characterization, it boils down to knowing the temperature of the surroundings around the atoms during the Ramsey interaction time, and also knowing some black body radiation coefficients as well. So we have this water cooling jacket around the atoms, and that helps us stabilize the temperature. We have three T-type thermocouples lined along this aluminum vessel, and these points represent averages of the three thermocouples averaged over a day, so we're continually measuring the temperature. And you can see that it's quite stable in time. So this uncertainty, the majority of that actually comes from the uncertainty in the calibration of our thermocouples. The stability is actually better than that. And when you, this leads to an uncertainty of about just under a part in 10 to the 16 for the bias from black body radiation. So as I said, I won't be able to go through all of these, but one that's typically interesting to talk about, as you've heard already, is the distributed cavity phase shift, but I won't talk about that because my colleague Bin Jian will be giving a poster about this later on. So I'd encourage you to attend that, to go talk to him if you're interested. Basically, these are the numbers we've evaluated it to at the moment, but we think we can drive this down using methods similar to what Catherine has mentioned earlier. So anyway, but Ben can talk about that a bit more. Another of the bigger ones here is at the bottom, which is in italics because we haven't done it yet really properly. Synchronous phase transients, that's something we still need to do to put a firmer upper bound on that. But one I will touch on is microwave leakage, because this is one that when you're building clocks, you sort of hope it just won't be noticeable at all, but it seems to show up in quite a few clocks, and we found it in ours, and we're able to suppress it, we think. So basically the idea is that you should only have interactions in the microwave cavities, but in reality, there's always some stray microwave fields interacting with the atoms outside of the cavities. So that could be below the cavities or above. In our fountain, it shouldn't be above because we have a below cutoff waveguide here, which should heavily suppress the interactions from any background microwaves. But that still leaves them exposed to microwaves below the cavity after the downward passage. So what we can do to test this is turn off the microwaves, essentially, just after the atoms have come back down through the cavity. But the way we do this is actually not turning off the power, but changing the frequency. So we use a frequency shift key function from our SDI to rapidly detune the frequency by about a megahertz. And we prefer to do this because it should result in less phase transients than changing the power, which could lead to thermal effects. So when we do this, first of all, if we don't do it, and we just look at the change in transition probability as a function of pulse area in the Ramsey cavity, we see this sort of oscillatory function with a linearly increasing amplitude. And that's sort of a hallmark of microwave leakage below the Ramsey cavity, as has been seen in some previous work. But when we use the frequency shift keying function, it seems to really effectively eliminate that. And the remaining residual effect fitting into this, we get something that's under a part in 10 to the 16. So finally, this is the last plot. Is we've started to do some comparisons of our clock frequency versus other primary frequency standards. And there's a lot of dead time in some of these measurements, but we're starting to run more and more as a dedicated measurements. And basically, we just need to keep taking more data. But at the moment, it looks promising. So finally, our fountain is performing reliably. It has very minimal unscheduled downtime. At the moment, our B-type uncertainty is about 3 times 10 to the minus 16, we think. And the short-term stability is about 1.5 times 10 to the minus 13, 1 over square root of